Okay. We are live. Tuesday morning, live. So, I feel our heart very strongly. It's so gorgeous to be four of us, be four humans feeling together. As one spirit. Wow. Just to so flawlessly be able to expand into our heart and our soul, our oversoul or something. How do you all feel about this? Please take the mic if you like.
Oh. I feel happy to be here. I feel at home. I feel like breathing deeply and expanding my chest. And I am curious how Nelly and us are going to handle the fact that I just received a really troubling email from my sister-in-law. So I have these two things going on at the same time. And I have to say I'm not totally sucked in, but it's in the background big time. So I would like to see how to handle in unity consciousness what it's possible to create with this thing in the space, because it's in the space.
Yeah.
So, if you guys,
sure,
maybe suggestions, you know, or whatever, you know. Normally I'm fine, you know, I don't have anything so pressing, but today is like this. So okay. I thought I'd mention it.
Well, thank you, Nelly, for sharing. That's great. You know, of course, anything that hasn't been assimilated or digested that needs to be attended to is going to want our attention until it is assimilated,
mm-hmm.
So and made sense of, and you have insights about how to relate to it. I mean, if it was a tiger, you know, clawing at your front door or something like that, it'll be the same thing. It'll be a little bit more urgent, maybe. But basically, the same mechanism is there. We need to have our attention captivated by something that needs to be attended to. Even if it doesn't need to be attended to, we know that there's something that is going to require our attention.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all on automatic. So if we really are attentive together, it will feel as though it's getting assimilated or digested or made sense of at the same time that we're doing what we're doing here, sharing sensitively. That would be my sense of it. Did you hear any of that, Frankie, about what Nelly said in the URL?
I heard something about getting a troubling email, but I had to go out and get the dog tended to.
Yes.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, well, that's a very similar situation. You know. Sister-in-law, the troubling email, the doggy had to go.
He was chasing flies behind the curtain, and he gets it all wrapped up in tears it all up, so I decided to put him outside a while. But he's okay.
Oh, good. Good. And so I, you know, I wonder, Nelly, I mean, we could all look at this and have a group experience. What, because we're not withdrawing attention from what has been, you know, triggered by receiving this email from your sister-in-law. Mm. We're staying present with it together. Is that helping for you to be with it?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I have to say that the very fact of being here, because I had a moment in which I said, oh, I cannot be in the hangout today, you know. But no, I said, no, I'm going. So plus your attention and my attention on my physical reactions, I think that I could offer without going into stories, but just offer my in the moment state of being. I don't know.
Yes. Well, we're, you know, let's say there's this transpersonal space of us all indivisibly awake as one here. And with this collective attention, our collective self can attend and observe the fact that we're all open to everything. We're not excluding or withdrawing our attention from anything or anyone in the universe. And so with our, as long as our attention, we're experiencing it as undivided, it can then support the assimilation of whatever this urgency may be. It can help us be with it without getting freaked out and fearful and feeling divided and resistant and wanting to fight or flee.
Exactly.
So what are all your insights about this transpersonal qualities? What is it capable of, our unity? Let's explore it. Okay, we've got a real life situation here. We've got emergency. Oh my God, the sky is falling. You know, the sister-in-law has written and it's very urgent. And I have to do something about it. I have to reply and be somebody in some way. Oh my God. So we can all be with that together, right? We don't have to necessarily talk about it, but we can focus on, we could just focus on our ability to hold it and feel it together. How about that at first, just to get grounded in the groundless ground? It's like meditating with it or something. Okay, I'm talking too much, so you guys talk now.
I'm so glad, Nelly, that you are with us. That your decision was to attend this exercise and this lovely place that we share together. And it will be okay for you to be here a while and let your sister-in-law's problem mature in you in a way that you can reply more I'm looking for the word and it comes out in Spanish. It's sabiduría, and it's, I guess I can translate it into wisdom. That your inner wisdom will be able to say the words or write the words that your sister-in-law will feel nurtured by, and that you will feel that it is her problem and not yours, really. Because I seem to think that there are three kinds of problems. One is what we can do to help solve it. If it's our problem, we will have the way to solve it. It can be someone else's problem, and we can accompany them during their trying time. And then another kind of problem, only time will solve. So we have to have the time to kind of step back and breathe and say, is this something I can really solve myself? Or what is my part in all of this? and be there. And know that just as we live here on this, I was going to say TV show. We live our experiences here and we share them. That's the way life is too. And it comes and goes. We aren't the same people we were 5 minutes ago. And so just know that your sister-in-law's problem will not be the same when we finish this. And it's okay for you to be here. And I'm extremely happy that you are. Thank you.
That's nice. I think I might be able to apply that same wisdom to my son. It might be a really cool way to problem solve with him. Could be really interesting. Thanks. So you've helped out some fathering here, too. That's great. Or we have. So the myriad, the network, how it is assimilated, our answers. So, I'm settling in, and I'm particularly tired this morning, or still waking up, maybe that's a better way to say it, and still remembering my trip to the volcano last night, was to see this really cool glow of the volcano lava, and it reminded me of awakeness, because there's this just magnificently large crater and just this glowing orange, you know, and it's just so still. I did get some video that I'm going to be editing and doing some stuff with, and it's pretty neat stuff, and I can, there's more understanding available of why when couch surfers stay with me here, one of the first things they'd like to do is go out to see the volcano. I don't know how many places on Earth people could see an active volcano, but it's definitely the centerpiece of Big Island's tourism. So it was pretty neat. Very much, very, very awake. Very awakening. So, all right, I pass the mic.
Should I go? I cannot really express how much grateful I am to be here and to be with you guys. It's like really, I feel like it's my home. It used to be that when something like today, like this email happened in the past, I was sucked into this dark place that used, you know, that was pretty much my home. I was like, oh yeah, it's dark and it's not fun, but it's my place. You know, I was more familiar there. Now I feel like, because of our hangouts, I feel like this is my home. You know, not that I, you know, meaning, and I can even welcome this thing, not welcome in the sense of, oh, please, but deal with this from inside this home rather than the dark place. Of Nelly's a bad person, you know, like that, all those conversations, you know. So what a difference. What, you know, this is already a life-changing difference. Like Frankenstein, you know, there are, you know, I'm not saying that my head is very clear or anything, but I can relate to the three kinds of problems she was saying and all the, you know, I can start putting a little bit of distance, kind of seeing it like It's not about me, you know, it's not, although action is required, but it's not like a reaction. It can be not a reaction. It's an action. Wow. What a concept. Also, I am into, lately, thanks to these hangouts, I am into this, I am into showing up, like showing up as, you know, like last time on Thursday, I had this big revelation that I'm alive. You know, once you become alive, you're alive. And there is no going back. There's no going back. I used to hide behind a finger and pretend I wasn't alive, you know, for, but now I feel like, wow, I'm alive. Everything is alive. We are alive together. There is nothing but life. So there's nowhere to go. I'm here to stay and to participate. So all of a sudden, I used to look for belonging. Now I change to participation. It's different. Belonging is someone that, you know, it's a little more passive in my view. And now I participate in life. So I can see, I can look at things both from personal perspective, but also as a participation to life. Whether I hope this makes sense, what I'm saying. And it feels like, yeah, I roll up my sleeves and I'm here to stay, not going away, not going anywhere. Thank you, guys. Pass the mic.
Nelly, when you find a good hiding place, you let me know. I feel that as I try to go forward, it's just a greater sense of responsibility with every step. So we just have to get up to it and put our head up high and keep on going, and everything works out fine. It's just this, the fear in us that kind of holds us back initially. But then we all gung-ho and we go to it. It's good. Well, I like to go to that place where we go on these hangouts. It's like what I call like the fifth dimension. Divine attributes. Joy, peace, love. It's so wonderful, and I feel that I would like to go there now, and I'm going there, and I'm there, because it's so much a part of what I enjoy, and it's so helpful for me to go there and to get nourished and live this life knowing that that is one dimension of me. And so now I feel my heart opening, and I feel the closeness that we share, that we are all one, and all of these cells in my body are one with all of the cells in your bodies, and we make up this multi-organism that gives me strength, and it gives me courage, and it reminds me of who I am. And I feel this love and this joy. And it's great to be here, and I thank you all for being part of this and for your sharing and your I'm trying to find the word again. I'm Spanish this morning for some reason. It's compromise. It's not a compromise like you say it in, like you mean it in English. It's being there for one another. And no matter what's happening in life, if I have to get up at 2:30 in the morning, or if I have to tune in even though I'm having an incident in life or anything, this is greater and this is wonderful, and it's the best thing I can do right now. Thank you.
I'm feeling so much beauty from being with all of you, each of you, and all that we are, so it makes it almost difficult to say anything that would mean anything. I guess I'd like to, if we can focus, in order to be as helpful as possible for each other and whoever might be listening to, if we could talk about what exactly are we doing to shift into this place of unity, where joy and love and this beauty just emerge spontaneously without even asking for it or even wanting it. It seems that for me, it's so great to be able to, without wanting to feel this wholeness, that just by noticing everything as a whole, that's the key. It's how well I'm noticing the wholeness that is noticeable to all of us, and that just sort of opens me and offers us to meet in this commonly sensed unity. How do you all get here? Who would like to speak in the mic now?
Well, I sense grazing on the gazing is one practice that definitely empowers my connecting and unifying, that by maintaining an unbroken gaze, there's a certain re-centralizing or it takes a little bit to stabilize, but it's a dynamic that tends to work pretty well for me. And when I've settled into maintaining eye contact, then there's a wholeness or a deep connected. There's a sense of peace and ease that's available. And I think I've said it before, it's a space that has a little bit of fear, or maybe like there's an excitement. We said earlier, in terms of a hiding place, when there's no hiding in unity consciousness, there's no hiding and deeply seeing and being deeply seen. So I think there's an aspect of facing fear that requires a bit of stretching oneself. So, all right, I'll pass the mic.
For me, yes, there is no place to hide. We all here, and there is an added element, which is declaring, "I'm here." You know, stepping up. So, you know, there is no fingers behind which we can hide. not only, but I step out, and you know. So, in fact, for me, what makes me, what I do to answer Sperry's question is, I make myself available. I make myself available, and when I say that, it comes from my heart. this part is becoming available. It's like my heart is in the middle there. With all of my you know, dark sides and everything, my son calls me weird. You know, weird means, by the way, I discovered that weird means faithful, you know, means a lot of great things, by the way. I just discovered that. But I feel like all my weirdness or uniqueness or my things are there, including, you know, if people jump into the hangout and find us weird, you know, like, what are they talking about? Including that, you know, there is this making myself available. And that makes me, I mean, there is a power in that. There is a power in being there. And that's when, for me, my heart sings, by the way, the singing of with love for you guys, for you, for life. So that's it. Pass the mic.
I connect through my breath. I take a deep breath, and that's part of all who I am, I think. It's because my body, my organs are being massaged as I breathe. I can feel them, and they're very present in my attention. My attention is on no duality. Like looking for that space that is right in the middle. And my attention is on being there, just being there, being present, being in the very exact moment that is occurring now. And it just happens. It's like a switch that comes on. And because of the practices we've been having and because of these hangouts that we've done over a certain period of time, it becomes easier every time I try. And that's what helps during the day, too. When I'm not in the hangout, then I use my breath and I remember our times together here, and I can apply it in my daily life. And it's really helpful, and it grows on you. Thank you.
Well, I do experience these same elements that you're all sharing about how to be here, how to get here. I'd like to, you know, say my own words or point in my own way about starting with what Brian was saying, is that, if I just attend to, with an unbroken gaze to the webcam lens, so I definitely feel that my awareness is being made available to your all's awareness and to whoever else might be tuning in here or watching this in the future, is that there is something that's been said for a long time about one-pointed attention, and that when my attention is pointed at the one place where we're all attending, and it doesn't have to be the webcam lens, but it could be me being aware of awareness and sensing as I relax into this unity that happens spontaneously if I let it. I notice this place where we're all hanging out, this awakeness, and that I know we're all here. So there's a psychological adjustment if I surrender to adjusting to just being awake here with all that is awake. And so it's more than just us being here, being awake. It feels like there's the whole of life is here being awake in the present moment. And as I notice more and more about this place and its qualities and its awakeness, then I do feel more and more whole. And I experience my whole body, heart, and mind adjusting incrementally, little by little, to this feeling of love and joy that arises spontaneously and unasked for, that I'm so grateful for feeling, that I feel so nourished by sharing and being indivisible from. There's definitely a non-dual, indivisible quality to this place where we're hanging out together. And that it really feels genuinely indivisible, and that brings about a feeling of security and safety. Seems those feelings seem to arise spontaneously and unasked for. It's not like I'm seeking love and joy and security and safety. But what is cool is that just being in one-pointed awareness here, where by focusing on one point, all points now have a reference frame. Everything can coexist in relationship to this one point that I am awake as with all of you. And so it's a conscious meeting or gathering whole, like the people in the community in a village would all come to a central place where maybe there was a spring where the village grew up around this source of water, and everybody would bring their urns to fill their water jugs to take back to their homes. This is like an artesian spring, this awakeness that is bubbling up from within us and everything at the center of our village, our consciousness, where we always know we can draw strength and nourishment. And so there are many psychological and physiological and spiritual and soulful qualities about unity and noticing the indivisible nature of oneness, I find. And I actually find that here. So it's great to rediscover it again and again, and how reliable it is to find it again and again. And that seems to be the main responsibility in life, is to be alive in this way with everyone and everything, as unconditional, eternal, present moment consciousness. Thank you. Who would like to speak next?
I have blank pages on my side again with the Google Chrome, so I'm going to reboot in Safari. So this time it's not a technical glitch. This is by choice. Okay. Be right back.
Oh, there's light, ephemeral light.
Okay. Well, it seems like Brian, are you going to talk?
No, he's going to go out and come back in. He may be frozen right now.
Oh, he's frozen. Okay.
Tomorrow, yeah.
It seems like you're talking about source, this point, this artesian well of nourishment, of going to. So to be awake, to have our attention and be awake and aware as that is everything. You know, there is everything there. So we are both the creature and the creator by pointing to that. And I realized all of a sudden that why churches, you know, have always been, in Europe at least, have always been built near water sources. There's a well, or there is a spring, or something.
Oh, no, it froze. Frankie, are you still there? Frankie froze, maybe. Okay. So, if you all are frozen here, let me. No, Frankie and Nellie are frozen. It's okay. We're this stillness. Brahman. Frankie and Nellie have frozen, so they'll come back in. But please, share.
Yeah, I'm booted on Safari this time, so.
Yeah.
No problems now.
So we're, you know, I just talked for a while. So if you would like to share, you know, how you share, how you come here, how do you stay here, what is it that you focus on, Brian? How do you welcome others? How do you offer this space to other people?
I think one of the big secrets is to be it. Because if there's... That was one of the major shifts on one is how do we just be awakeness? Because to contextualize or to attempt to contextualize being awakeness, it's beyond an identification. It's an embodiment of a formless, right? So it's this ultimate paradox that kind of the brain gives up in terms of the thinking, trying to logically get it. Yeah, there's nuances, there's tasks, there's ways of doing stuff that helps. But I think just by being awakeness really makes a big difference. And I have some incense going, so there's this etheric smoke that's filling my space here, if you enjoy that with me. Yeah, so Nellie Sperry asked me about how do I get here. ability in resting or resourcing, you know, sourcing again, and just to be source. That's good. I like it.
Wow. Hmm. Okay, you're
all
there again.
Yeah, you're live.
Brian, if you invite us to the hangout, would we be affected when you sign off?
No, that's a cool feature that Google put in there, that it's even if I dropped out of the call permanently, people can continue to hang out. So it's kind of like a hub and spoke. Instead of one central, like, it doesn't put me in the center where if I drop out, everybody drops out. It's a ring, and I'm just one on the ring. And so if I drop out, now if we all drop out, it might stop the hangout.
It's a quantum hangout.
Quantum hangout. Yeah.
Well, I wonder if it kept recording then when you all froze and dropped out, and then eventually I got an indication that there was a network failure. Mm. So who knows? We'll find out. So.
Well, I went through that when we had the first recording. We had the same thing, a network failure, I think, somewhere in the middle section.
Oh.
And it continued to record.
Oh.
So when we finished, when I hit exit, it finalized the video or something like that. So hopefully the same happens here.
Okay. Yeah. So I guess, Brian, you were answering that question of, like, how do we offer this source, this sense of indivisible wholeness, of, you know, awake and aware unity. You know, we're creating these hangouts to offer this place to meet and gather and share this one that we all are. And so, I don't know how. It seems like this is our time is well spent to notice that how we can go very deep, see how deep we can go into this indivisible place where we are all nourished. What do you all find in exploring this experientially right now?
I shared, and you dropped off. It was a being awakeness, to shift from pointing to there's a element of imagining or pretending or maybe dropping all pretense and just being awakeness. And then as you were asking the question, I think maybe even a third aspect came up, which is to just point awareness or point my attention to attention itself. So instead of pointing it to things or to the absence of things or to judgments and feelings and opinions or any of these other past habitual patternings and running old code, it's just to set the code back on itself or put attention to its attention. So then in this light, there's, for me, I guess, three main keys. One is to graze on the gaze, which is to maintain an undivided, unbroken eye contact. Two would be to put my attention on attention itself. And three is to just be awakeness. So there's no longer pointing to it. I am it. I am awakeness. I am attention on attention. somehow I feel that I just answer this, so back to you, Sperry.
Well, I agree that just being awakeness is the non-dual. You know, it's like apparently when Buddha was asked, are you a saint or, you know, what's the story? He said, I'm awake. You know, I'm not a man, I'm not a saint, I'm just awake. And this awakeness does seem to contain the totality. There's one without a second here. When we talk about attention to attention, I think it's important, I feel, to mention that experientially when I attend to our collective attention, that I notice that it just merges. It's like water being poured into water. There's no subject-object as I completely surrender and let go. And then attention to attention just dissolves into this ocean of a pure, indivisible awakeness, consciousness itself. Frankie and Nellie, what do you find?
What comes to me is that there is no, for me, it's like when there is no subject and object, but I am both, you know, like, so it's not like, it's not even, there is a stage, I should say, in which I'm not even nourished, I am nourishment, you know, it's like, I am the nourishment. So it's the I, like Ken Wilber talks about the I, the subject and the I. So I feel that is, I don't know, there are some words for me that trigger that. You know, like when you said source, for me, that kind of did it. So I don't really know how to do it every single time. For me, I'm going back to the showing up. I'm making myself available. But in the minute that, just like in quantum physics, right? I make myself available, so I am the hangout. And by coming to the hangout, I am it, with all that it entails in terms of attention, the grazing, the gazing, and all that. That's how it happens. And kind of also, I have this feeling here in my heart today. You know, it's like, kind of, it's like the attention is going from not just the eyes to my heart. Maybe there are eyes in the heart too. I don't know. Like when I make myself available, it's this that, you know, not my head only. The energy comes from here. I'm exploring here, so I'm not sure what I'm saying. But I'm offering this. And thank you.
Okay. Having been a meditator for many, many, many years, I find that this is more complete, because trying to quiet my mind and putting my attention on something is important. But here I've learned that my body is also incorporated in this experience. And it kind of blends everything together. And as you say many times, Barry, it's a mind-body-heart experience. And so every part of me is present. Every cell in my physical body, every part of my soul, every spiritual part that exists, My mind is completely in cooperation with experience. And so it's to me very fulfilling, because it's something that I can completely experience. All that I am is a part of all that is. And so attention is very important and keeps my mind in focus. And the spiritual part is there because there's so many loving sentiments and so many feelings that are there in unity. And my body is also here with me in this experience. And that to me has made a big difference. Because while meditating, I was taught to try to not experience the body and to cut off all contact with my external environment and just focus on this other thing. And many times just go to another place and not really be here fully. But hanging out with you has enabled me to incorporate my body, my surroundings. Everything is part of this that is all. And that has been very unique and very fulfilling, because that's really a part of me. Thank you.
Yeah, I feel that meditation, because it's done usually in isolation, we're in this sort of, you know, we're individually meditating, and to be meditative, and so to find the maximum amount of aware awakeness as a lone individual, it seems natural enough to just give all of our undivided attention to how awake and aware we feel in the moment as we're sitting still and silently by ourselves. And I know that that can go a really into this total unity in some ways. You know, if I devote several days to meditating like that, I can definitely get into a place of indivisible union with the whole body of nature and the whole cosmos, and be the void, and everything is everything else and everywhere else, as I've spoken of before. Though that requires a lot of, days and days, round the clock meditation for that to happen, to really embody everything as this timeless, void-based consciousness. And that is very exquisite. Though I think in the short run, individual meditation just doesn't, there's just not enough time. We have to get back into dealing with thoughts and things and activities and people and situations. So I have been exploring this for over 30 years here, where this is something we can do together to be in that vastness. And the more we really explore it and experience it, it makes it so much more accessible to be fully embodied and indivisible from the whole of life, and how and be fulfilled by this, by the exquisiteness of how actually nature is happening as us and through us and with all of us. So that this is a way that our whole species, the whole of humanity, can develop this habit to be this way with all that is. How do you all feel about that?
I feel that this is what is. I mean, it's what humanity has access to now, and this is the right way because it's so easy, it's so graceful, it's so of the moment that. It's so fulfilling that this has to be right, and we have to be doing it at the right time for it to be this way, and to be able to incorporate it into our lives also. And coming together this way, I had always wondered how it was going to happen, that we would form these loving communities, and this is a beautiful way to start. It's so nice and so right. And I think it's just what is at the moment the most important thing that we can do now. Become aware, live consciously, and come together this way so that that would be repotentiated and exponentially multiplied to radiate out in other ways.
Nice share. Yeah, it was really nice. I have the warm fuzzies. And what's up for me is this sense of when someone has a 30-year mission, you know, it's like a trip out of our solar system and back. But to have a level of commitment that they know that this is it. And you know, I choose to know how many people on Earth have been committed to an ideal for, you know, 3 decades or longer to make something manifest. And I sense that most of the heartfelt projects that many decades have been committed to are worthy of being made manifest here, you know, for all the right reasons and for all the reasons we don't even know of. And I think when Sperry shares about we're at the precipice of the 6th mass extinction, which is a crisis, we also have the opportunity of the 6th mass awakening. And this is a real pivotal time for humanity. We have this opportunity. And, you know, our awakeness hangouts, letting love levitate, I'm really enjoying this early stage, you know, just to really get this initial early connection where we know that we're up to something, you know, we really get that, whoa, this is something that can really change our humankindness, can change our dream, can awaken from and into something greater. And it's I was sharing with Sperry before on kind of our catch-up calls that any enterprise or any venture looks to deliver on its promise of its premise. So the premise we have is letting love levitate. We have a premise of awakeness, that there's an experience that we can promise of which we deliver. And people are referred or not referred to organizations or individuals because their ability to deliver on their promises. And consistently, even just in one hangout, you know, some couch surfing buddies and friends that have hung out here, they're like, whoa, you know, they have this experience of like, that was amazing. And I'm just really making a point here that there's so much in today's culture, especially in the amount of content and media that's available instantly for people to tune in and to change channels and to go something else, to have an experience that can deliver in 90 minutes or 2 hours that gives people an immersive experience to awaken as one and to be in unity consciousness, to have a shared common sense, and to have an experience that many transcendental meditators spend years and years and years on, and they can have in one session guaranteed, is amazing. Just simply profound that this is what we're able to do. And I think it's relevant and it's poignant, and it points to the fact that this is probably for the first time that we've taken an ego or a personality out of the picture. And it's not about one teacher or one guru or one dude or dudette that is sharing the info like, hey, everybody look at me, I'm going to point our attention to attention. It's about transcending that integral level into transpersonal, that it is beyond us. It's beyond each of us, and it's us being awake and putting our attention on attention itself, and to resource, to come from source and to be source, that is so empowering. It is this shift that we go from many, many gears and many, many contents changing channels into this neutral, and all speeds are available because we just become source. So I am equally hopeful that we've tapped into something that is simultaneously beyond our current paradigm, and it is who we are at our most essential nature. And this is what makes it also relieving or relaxing, or as Nellie shares, it feels like home. So I welcome us home, and I welcome us to the great adventure that, you know, is unfolding for us. And I thank our early participants because, you know, we're part of the bedrock here to awaken humanity. Okay, we got 9 minutes. This is the 90-minute shorter Tuesday session, so thank you. Pass the mic.
I find that this 90 minutes are so power-packed. So much power in this 90 minutes. And I feel so fortunate and so excited to be both the creature of this hangout and the creator. You know, like I growing into it, I changed my life, and at the same time also creating it together with you. Adjusting to it, watching the videos, all the stuff that we've been doing in this last since when I joined, and so it's like being the home and the inhabitant, you know. This is so amazing. It's really, and it's changing my. First of all, I'm happy that this. To have found this, because I in the isolating meditation mode, I was not, you know, it wasn't my thing. In fact, I always tried to meditate with other people, you know. So to be in community, to have it all, community and being in awakeness and being one, it doesn't get any better than this, really. So As I go deep into this practice, I deepen the practice, I also find myself sharing about it, you know, sharing about it, because it's everything in my life points to this. You know, it's normal. And now being on air, we don't really know what's going to come out of this, but we are here. We are really pioneers, I think, of this. And, you know, I can testify any minute that it works. You know, it really does work. And it changes people's lives. Thank you.
Besides being an opportunity to be aware and to feel and to experiment oneness, unity, it's a place of healing and transformation. It's life-changing. And it's through this experiential opportunity that we can be one with ourselves, all of what we are, and be one with others, and be one in life, and feel the joy of life, and remember who we are and why we're here. It's profoundly transformative. Thank you.
I've been pretty consistently just gazing grazing on the gazing here in an unbroken way, looking, being aware of the quality and presence of awareness to whatever extent I am capable of being aware of it. One pointedly looking at the webcam, making my own awareness available to your awareness, to our awakeness. And what I'm noticing is that just in being, noticing the noticing, there is an incremental and constant progressive shifting into this place of really everywhere throughout every cell in my body feeling this perceptual process, this, you call it reimagining of the body-mind, the recreation of, through perceptual activity, but it's about clearly about becoming, for me right here, and has been, and I noticed this throughout all my 30 plus years of meditating, is that it's about perception becoming perceptive to itself, so that there is that in reincorporation of the very activity of perceiving, becoming conscious of itself. So there is an integration in the whole body, heart, and mind, personally and socially. Technologically, it's happening. It's in the quantum physics and modeling consciousness and physics. You see this indivisibility, this timeless, eternal now being displayed as space, time, energy, and matter, mind, and body. And, so all the answers are available right here, and we can live, I find, without needing to question. As this beautiful poem Michaela sent this morning about surrendering without, that when we really surrender, there is what we're feeling here right now. And I can attach this poem to this video. When we're fully surrendered, we're just in this total luxury of peace and beauty and in pure intelligence. Is it time to, oh, we've got good, a minute and a half to left. Who, let's all share in whatever way, please.
Yeah, it's a good time to open up our mics.
I think our mics have been open the whole time. Which is really nice to do it this way.
Sperry, have you seen that when you talk, was it automatically switching to you?
Yes, perfectly.
Beautiful. Well, then it's probably still, you know, it's probably the YouTube live streaming is probably continuing to work. If you see that feature is happening, so that's cool. Well, thanks, friends. Good to see you Tuesday. 90-minute power session.
Yes.
Great. Love you.
Yeah, the power of shared presence.
Yeah. So I'm working on that hangout lower third. I should have, it looks like we can also do a little logo, so we could put a little square up. And I think I might do one of those awakeness logos that we can have, and then we can have, we could figure out our color banner and stuff like that we can set up. And then once I get that, we can share that with our group, so we can put, you know, name, little tagline, and then have the our little awakeness logo up in the corner for us.
Little branding.
Yeah, get some branding going. Yeah.
Well, it would please me a lot if it was possible to have it go not be up there the entire time. Is it possible to?
Oh yeah.
Or something.
We can turn it on and off.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, it's kind of live on the fly. We can even change it. You can, we can turn it off.
Yeah. Super duper.
Okay.
All righty, lovelinesses. We are loveliness.
See you next time.
Okay.
Okay, see ya.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.